Here we go. Hello, hello again. Welcome once again to this week's Discussing Tabletop for March 18th, 2017. I hope everybody is having a great Saturday. It's time to talk about some tabletop gaming once again. Of course, I'm here with my usual guest, my partner in crime himself, Joe. But this week, we have a special guest, Rachael. Rachael, you'll be able to pimp out anything you want at the end of the show. I don't know what I'm looking for a word there. Promote, that's the actual word. Why did I go that direction? All right, then. Well, whatever.
You're such a pimp, Matt.
I know, I am. All right, well, let's get started with the topics for this week, because, you know, why don't we dive right into things. Today, this week, we're first going to start out with, of course, a little bit more Magic the Gathering. Not as big as last week. I do want to briefly talk about the changes in the ban, but that's going to be a small one, because we might have a guest next week who can help us talk about that more in depth. Then we're going to move and talk about Mind versus Might, and the fact that this is showing off older legends and older characters rather than ones that are from nowadays when it comes to Magic the Gathering. From there, we will move on to talking about some Dungeons & Dragons. First off, with Dungeons & Dragons Beyond, the new app that's been announced. We're going to talk about that for a little while. Then we're going to talk about some Unearthed Arcana with the Mystic. We want to discuss that. We're going to move on to then some Pathfinder with the Monster Hunter's Handbook. And talking about some other classic types of adventures. The thing is, I don't see them ran so much anymore. The monster hunting adventure, where you're specifically on a hunt for a monster. And there's a couple other adventures like that, which they show up, but not as much anymore. Then we're going to move on, and of course we will be talking about Tales of Equestria. It came up gathering the role, and I wanted to talk about role-playing games that are based upon TV shows and movies. Where do we draw a line too far? That's a good question about it. I'm just interested in what people are going to think about it. We'll move on to that. From there, we are going to talk about Vares, a card game which has just gotten a free PDF version you can print out, and you can, you know, that's it. It's a free version of this game. You don't have to buy it. You can print it out on your own. You got the game. That's it. All right. So, everybody, why don't we dive into the first topic at hand? We're going to talk about Might versus Magic, or Mind versus Magic in Magic the Gathering. So this one's interesting because we've only seen basically the packaging. We haven't seen the deck list, and it is coming out very soon this month. It's got two characters, Joyra and Lovista, from Ice Age. Now, a little background. Magic has had a lot of years of content that have come out. Ice Age is probably early to mid were the time periods when they touched upon this time period in Magic history, because they had their main plane, because they do planes similar to Dungeons & Dragons does planes. Their main one, Dominaria, which they've only really touched on in the recent years. They used to do it all the time back in the old days, and they had their own history for it. This touched on a certain period of time, basically, again, in their first half of making Magic cards. And they're diving into this, well, it's not something I mind, because they're diving into a catalog of very interesting characters and things that they've established over the years, and they're showing it off now. And, I mean, I think the characters were interesting, and they had interesting abilities, but the question is, like, what does this mean we'll see more stuff like this? Because Magic's been taking a lot of interesting routes, and I think I'm curious what you think, Joe, because you're probably the one out of us here that's, other than me, that's going to have a good opinion on this.
Well, I think it's interesting they're going back to Ice Age. I mean, Ice Age was released in June of 1995. So we're harking back really to early Magic.
Well, the thing is, I think these ones are from Cold Snap, technically. Which was...
Okay, Cold Snap was what, maybe 99, 2000?
It's in the 2000s, because that's when they decided to have a proper third one in the Ice Age block.
Let me see. I'm just bringing up the information to see if I can source out a date here. 2006, actually. So, yeah, 2006. So that's actually only 11 years ago.
But you have to think about it. that was specifically made to finish off a block they felt was unfinished. You know?
True. So it's interesting that they're going back, especially since they're not really focusing on, you know, standard or anything right now. They're
focusing on standard. They're not talking about modern.
Not standard. I'm modern. That's what I meant. Sorry.
Yeah.
They're focusing on modern now, not standard. But the last release before this was modern.
Mm-hmm.
And now they're going modern again when they're saying that they're trying to focus on standard. So it's weird that they keep diving back into the modern realm.
Especially since we've seen the more recent dual decks have been more about whatever set or block is going out.
Right, they've been doing it more on the current story.
Yeah, this is very interesting because of that. Because it's like, this is definitely... Like, they had, like, Nissa versus Obnixilis, which was one that they came out during the last Eldrazi block, which had to deal with the fact that they had, in the storyline, they came against each other during that storyline.
And they're bringing back Suspend in this one.
Okay.
Which is a mechanic we haven't seen in a while. If you look, Jorah...
Oh yeah. Aurora. Oh yeah, yeah.
She actually has you can discard a non-land card to give four time counters and give a card suspend.
Well, was she might because wasn't it that they had the two time blocks, they had three time sets. It was really weird back during that time. They sort of sandwiched Cold Snap, I think, after Time Spiral and then went back to the rest of the Time Spiral block. So it was, like, sort of really weird there that they did, like, four sets in a row. And I don't really understand why they've done some weird things with timing overall. They've kind of come up with a interesting way of doing things now when they release sets. But it's definitely, you know, it harkens back to that time period. And I can understand an old mechanic if these are technically reprints of older cards. I mean, they really are. But
I'm just saying, I'm surprised. We haven't seen that mechanic in a while.
That's true. And they're choosing these with that mechanic to bring to the forefront. That's true. I agree with you. It's very interesting.
And when's the last time have you seen a Berserker card?
I don't remember.
Because Lavosa's ability goes for Barbarians, Warriors, which Warrior's common. Barbarian, we haven't seen that much either. Or Berserker gets +2/+2 and has haste.
If you had a Barbarian Warrior Berserker deck, hey, it's great.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, we haven't seen Barbarians and Berserkers for a long time either, so they really are digging back into the Magic archives.
They might have a little bit of it that we just don't think about because it might be like a sub-ability or something, you know? Like, it's a second.
Well, it's a character, you know, it's a creature type.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, we don't see those creature types... Even if they are out there, it's not as often or as prominent as it used to be.
That's true. Yeah, I don't think they'd show up.
Especially Berserker.
Yeah, Berserker.
I mean, Warrior is the only one out of the three that pretty much stays relevant.
Yeah. There have been officially 65 Berserkers over the time of Magic.
That's not a lot.
No, but it's a decent amount, and they do show up in random places. Like, there was some in Scars and stuff. There was some in one of the Theros sets. So, I mean, they do show up, I just don't think in great number.
Right, but that's what I'm saying, is it's something that's more of a rarity that they're bringing back for this.
Yeah, it's like, you can find Berserkers...
Barbarian was more common earlier on. I don't think it has been as common.
And Warrior actually functions as a tribe now in a set. Because I think, like, if you're looking between the entire history of Magic, then all of these work fine. You can have, like, a Berserker set, definitely. There's 65 different ones of them. But you're not looking at one block. You're looking at, like, one thing of them.
Right.
Which is... Barbarian might be a little better, but Warrior, I know, like, the Khan's block had Warriors of the Wazoo, you know? So...
Hey, stop putting Warriors in your Wazoo.
I don't think I will be acknowledging that one any more than that.
And you know what else I have to say?
What?
For any Kevin Smith fans out there, uh-huh. My love for you is like a truck, Berserker.
Uh-huh. Oh, there's far less Barbarians. There's only 31 Barbarians.
Oh, wow. I would have thought there would have been less berserkers.
That's true. Odd. But anyway, but it's very interesting. It's 551 warriors.
Yeah, the warriors I knew were a lot more common.
You can make a warrior deck.
You can make several warrior decks.
Oh my god, yeah. But I think this is an interesting one, definitely, that they're diving back into their history a little bit. I feel like Wizards is doing that with both things. We're going to talk D&D and about the Mystic. I feel like that's dragging back some of their own history also a little bit. And we're going to talk about that. So this is interesting that this week we're almost seeing, like, Wizards says something and then does something else. And it confuses
Wizards
me a lot.
Wizards says they're going to do this and then starts doing the opposite for some reason. Which is like, okay, are you trying to mess with us?
Oh, yeah.
We're not going to really be supporting this as much anymore. Now we're going to come out with a bunch of decks for it. Okay.
I don't know. Again, I'm interested.
Maybe they're trying to just appease everyone.
It's true. I still would like to see what this means for more stuff in the future, definitely. So, I guess we'll take a look what happens after here when it comes to Magic. Why don't we move on, though, because that was fun to talk about. Why don't we move on to talk about some D&D? Because I didn't want to dive into so huge amounts of magic since we had so much we talked about last week.
Yes. And we don't have a magic guru this week.
Not that,
yeah, got nothing.
It's fine. I mean, if you wanted to put your two cents in about it, that's fine. We take it.
I've played 3 games.
Well, then you're not a complete noob.
Yes.
I couldn't tell you how I won. I was just like, I'm going to do whatever this card says. And people were like, awesome. Thanks. I was like, yeah, I did something good, right? Yeah, awesome.
It's like, yeah, thanks. You did something good for you.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, why don't we talk about D&D Beyond? Because this got announced at PAX East. So this is actually their new digital tool set. So it's an app. It is basically a good way of describing it.
Has the app been released? Because I couldn't find it.
It hasn't been released. The beta is coming out Monday.
Okay, that makes sense now.
Mm-hmm. So you can go to their site and sign up for the beta, which I did. So I'll see if I get any information about it. But they did.
Yes, I'm here.
They did tweet online that it's right now. It seems like they're just having the rules are really the big thing that's coming out with it, but they're planning on having like tools for it, rules. Like race, class information, character creation, spells, monsters, everything. Like, you know, it's supposed to be a compendium of information that you can use. So it's like when we think of like masterwork tools for Pathfinder, I thought it was like that, but jacked up to 11.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So
now, is it going to be a free thing or is it going to be paid? Is the question.
Oh, I don't know.
From what I've read, I believe it's going to be a mix. Almost, they say it's not going to be microtransactions. But they did say that it will be, like, if you want everything to know about a fighter, you can buy a fighter pack, so to speak. Or you can buy, you know, the whole set of rules of everything.
Okay. So it's not free like the Pathfinder one is, but you can buy a bulk thing of it.
Basically. From what I read, it sounded like it will cost. It just didn't say how much. It didn't say, like, what the kind of, like, tiered plans are, if it's subscription-based or, you know, a one-time purchase. It just said that it's not, they're trying not to go with a microtransaction model, but they like want it to be as flexible and as kind of customizable for what you can buy versus not buy for people who are more casual gamers and just want, I only want stuff about, you know, bards. They can just pick exactly what they want.
That's definitely interesting. And it, I'm interested to see what they're going to end up doing with this, because that will say for me if I'm going to be wanting to get it or not. I mean, that's the thing, is like, I'm not going to want to spend a lot of money on anything. As cool as it might be, I don't know if it's going to be so useful to me. The fact is, like, I have a couple of books, I have a couple more PDFs, and most of the time I can have something in front of me that I can work with. So I'm not having much trouble. But I understand that there's people that this might help a lot with. I don't know about it. You know, that's the best thing I can say about it. It seems like an interesting... I signed up for the beta to check it out. We'll see.
Yeah. And I know for like somebody like you know, like you or I, who probably already have, you know, I have a stack of books next to me that's, you know, 5 books high with all the books. I've spent my, I don't know, 40 times 4, 40 times 5, whatever amount towards the game. I've got a couple of the PDFs that I want. I've got the Google. So I have access to everything I need when I'm playing online. When I'm playing face-to-face, I usually print out whatever I need from PDFs or whatever. It's, if you're just getting into it, I think it's going to be more beneficial than if you've already, you know, if you've been with 5e since the beginning, since it came out, you know, 2013, 14. So it's, I feel it's going to be more helpful for new players getting into it, who are like, okay, I don't have to lug around 600 pounds of books now. I can just throw it all on my phone and, you know, show up and play a game.
It's true. For me, depending on the price, I might go for it. I only have the player's handbook.
Okay.
So for me, it might be useful, but I'll have to see. I mean, again, just like you said, you're, I have Google, I can download PDFs and stuff, so I can get away around other ways, and Matt has most of the books, and he's the one who I normally game with, so...
Yes. Yeah, I'm normally the one mostly here that, you know, or if I don't have it, we have a friend that has everything else I don't have, you know, and more, because he can afford to get, like, all the books. You know, I get a couple of them that I can really get, Joe got the one... And, you know, so we have this network of, oh, do we need, like, a physical copy of this? Great, you know, we could really go to someone and be able to borrow it if we really needed to. Granted, that's maybe more of a character creation, or if you really wanted, like, something out of it printed for some of your characters, you could definitely go to, like, go to some place that has a copier and copy, like, a bit out of it. I mean, there's, like, the extra spending... The extra incentive to spend, I don't know if it's big enough there. And I think the, well, I was going to say, for me, the beta has this, like, hurdle to go over to say to me, you'd want to spend money on this.
Mm-hmm. Right. The only nice part about having an app like that is the search function, if it has one. Is that you can find information quicker than trying to flip through the book or, where is it? Ah, here it is.
Yeah.
You can just type in what you're looking for and it'll pop up. They have that search function on the Pathfinder one. So hopefully, I'd hope D&D would have an index or a search function like that.
Very true.
The other thing I thought that was kind of cool that I read about was that they're going to have almost like character sheets and character builders. So I'm wondering if you're a DM and you have the app, can you actually, you know, immediately have access to everybody's character sheet and all their stats right there in front of you, so you don't have to go, oh, you know, Joe, what is your, you know, what is your AC, because you don't have it right there in front of you. So that could be, like, the flip side where it's kind of going to be helpful, maybe.
The other thing I could think of, too, is if they make it compatible with, like, Roll D20 or something where you could export a character sheet from that app to something like that.
That's true. Yeah.
That would be a really great function, because then you could create your character on your, you know, on your mobile device and be like, okay, I'm uploading it to here. Here's my sheet.
And I know Roll20 has been trying to, like, partner with groups. Didn't they partner with, was it Pathfinder recently? That you can get a lot of stuff from them?
Yeah, I think they recently did Pathfinder. And, I mean, I think Wizards would be smart to do, you know, to do that as well, because as we're starting to see, it's a lot easier to get people to play, you know, find people to play on something like that than it is locally sometimes.
Yes.
Yeah, like the online community, especially Roll20, has expanded things greatly. And this is almost an extension of it, a need for some kind of, like, app like this. Because, I mean, there are people that use Roll20 on, like, a tablet. And you could very well be, okay, thanks, Olren. Olren has pointed out that Roll20 does have some official 5e content already. Okay, so see, we already have some official stuff from 5e, from Pathfinder and stuff. And, like, if I'm on there, and I'm on a tablet, and I want to maybe switch over to the app, I can do it all in one thing, you know? I don't have to have a book around me. I could be playing maybe with people, and I wouldn't have as much trouble as, like, you know, flitting around with the books and stuff while I'm doing it. And I could see there's an opportunity for it to be very useful. But again, it's like money versus convenience, and I think that's what we're going to have to see what it gives us.
Yeah, it definitely depends on
how good the app is.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we've seen, like, with the Pathfinder one, relatively it's great, but they don't update as often.
No, they put out only some of the main core books, and that's about it. Like,
so you still
books.
Have to kind of go back to their web to the website.
Well, the website then is like run by a third party, which is like very when like it's one of those interesting things. Is they're yeah. technically correct information, but they have to like change certain names and stuff, and it gets weird.
Right, but I'm just saying that the website's more normally more up to date than the app is.
That's true. That's very true. You know, the PDF, D20 PSFRD for Pathfinder. Yes.
Yeah. I think.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say another thing that I read that it is another, like, maybe kind of hurdle to them is that it didn't read like it's going to be a virtual tabletop. It read like it's just going to be rules and character sheets and, like, everything you would need to play except the tabletop. So I don't know if that's going to hinder it or help it because, you know, you're taking out, like, the chunk of all the books and putting them together, but then you still have to worry about the tabletop and this, you know, that aspect of it. So I feel like that could kind of go either way for them.
Well, yeah, but if they do a deal like Pathfinder did with Roll D20,
get more stuff up on there.
Yeah, and you can take stuff in the app and pop it up onto there. Then that solves that problem. They don't have to have the tabletop built in.
Someone already has it. Yeah. So it's gonna.
Well, and I know they have it built into Fantasy Grounds already too.
Okay. Well, we'll have to see how things go here. I know the beta comes out Monday. I believe you can still sign up for it if you'd be interested in checking it out.
Yes, you can. I just did.
Okay. So you can still sign up for the beta. Just check out some of the information. Again, you know, I guess it's coming out soon. They're working on it. We'll just have to see how things go from there. It's going to be an interesting one to at least see. We'll probably have more on it, discuss on it, when we know more. All right. Why don't we move on, though? And thank you for the links, Jade Vala, in the
That's
chat.
That's me.
Oh.
Now you can put it all together.
Yes.
Yay!
Yes. Hurrah! Let's move on to the Mystic.
Unearthed Arcana?
Yeah, Unearthed Arcana. So, they came out with the Mystic, which I didn't know this, but it sounds like this is an update of something they had done in Unearthed Arcana before. I hadn't, you know, ever checked it out before because, you know, I didn't dive into Unearthed Arcana for, like, probably, like, 6 months ago. I really started getting into paying attention to what they're putting out. So, I mean, that's, like, 6 months ahead of there that they could have put out something like this. So this sounds like they've... From what I've heard online, you know, and... Okay, so yeah, Aurent tells me it's the first one they did, very bare bones. And this,
very bare bones, yes.
Yeah. And this update version, and it's psionics. And it sounds like, because, you know, I have a small understanding of psionics from second edition, a little better understanding of what they did in third edition and beyond, you know. It from what I know from that, Artificer was first a subclass of Wizard, actually, in Unearthed Arcana before they made it their own class. Interesting. Well, that's cool. Thank you again, Alrin. But anyway, as I was saying, it feels a lot more like the second edition version of it. You get a psionic discipline. You have a number of talents, disciplines known. You get a mystic order, I'm sorry. So you get psionic talents, psionic disciplines, psi points, and psi limits. Talents are like minor powers, so we think of them like cantrips, you know, it sounds like that what they are. Disciplines, I feel like that, like, when I'm comparing a little bit of it here, I'm almost comparing it a little bit like maybe like a step away from like war. It goes from like wizard to warlock to this, you know, with how they put like the kind of the way they're doing powers a little bit. You know, I just feel like that, because it feels like those with the disciplines are more like, but except you have to spend psi points on them.
Basically the orders, though, are basically the different psionic classes they used to have.
Ah.
Like, you have Order of the Soul Knife.
I totally missed out there was an Order of the Soul Knife. Oh my god.
Order of the Wujin.
Oh, yeah, yeah, okay. Yeah.
Those were all originally, you know, classes before. So that's basically what the orders are the different psionic classes that they used to be.
Okay. And I see here, like, you can spend, like, psi points to get your blade to do more damage. Mm-hmm. Like, you can regain psi points by murdering things. I mean, defeating things in combat.
Murder.
So it looks very interesting to me that they've done this. I mean, again, I back in my second edition days only knew basic stuff about psionics. So, like, comparing it together isn't going to give me a huge amount of information right now. You know, I know it's not going to be like an exact development from it.
Yeah, I mean, I'm more familiar with the 3.0 and 3.5 psionic stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But this seems to be going pretty much along those lines.
With some changes, because, like...
There's definitely going to be changes, but I'm saying, in general,
mm-hmm.
It resembles a lot of that.
Yeah.
From just a rough overlook.
Because, like, you have a limit, you've got psionic focus, you can recover, telepathy is very cool, strength of mind. Okay, the disciplines and talents are after the thing. I have to remember that's where they are. Adapt. And, okay, so see, like, this is cool here. Like, a discipline, adaptive body. You can choose different things for different amounts of psi points. And, of course, you have a limit to the amount of psi points you do. So I would know adaptive body. I would choose one of the... use one of the abilities with it using a certain amount of psi points per turn. There are disciplines linked to each of the... Like, it seems to be different groups. Like, there's Wugen, Avatar, Awakening, Immortal that get the different ones. Where are the talents?
A lot lower.
There's a lot of pages in here.
Yes. Psionic talents start on page 27.
I see them here. Yeah. Oh.
Like Blade Meld. That's always a classic one.
Yeah, Blade Meld. Mm-hmm. Bonus action, your one-handed melee weapon becomes one with your hand. All right, then. You can't lose
it. You can't let it go, and it can't be forced from your grasp. Congratulations, you're Wolverine.
But it's great if you're going against, like, a fighter that uses disarming strike, because they can't knock your weapon from you.
Exactly.
So
it's part of your body now.
Yeah. Unless they literally disarm you.
Yes. I guess they could still try to cut your arm off, but
that's all tails, hack the arm off.
Cold shot left arm.
Yeah.
That's a disadvantage though.
Yes, a disadvantage.
Hey Matt, cold shot, left foot.
That was you.
We can upgrade doing to you me. To a laser foot.
Oh, my God. Please not that story again. I don't know if we've told it on the show, but we...
Yes, we have, when we talked about my game before.
You shot off my foot.
With a Tommy gun. Reverse style, because it went down your body.
You think the kick would have done it the other way, but nope, apparently not.
And it happened twice.
Yeah, it happened twice. Anyway, the other time it sounded a lot more realistic, because I think they just shot me in the foot and not in the leg at all.
Yes. And then your foot blew up and you got a stun foot!
Look, your game has had interesting things, and we talked about it, the game system you made up. So, I mean, that was a good story for it, and, you know, we can reflect upon that that calling a shot for something would reflect similar to that. Yeah. So, it looks like you get things like you can... regain hit points for using psi points, which is cool. Like recovery. What else do you get? You can replace your proficiency in wisdom saving throws whenever you take a short or long rest, and choose one of the other ones. Huh. And it changes. So like, so they can change around their proficiencies and saves, which is interesting too. So it's like, oh, we're gonna go mess around with like some kind of poisonous creature.
I'm good at saving against that now.
Yeah, I got, like, constitution saves that I'm good at. That's interesting. So that's cool. I kind of like the style of it a bit. That's what I have to say about it. I find it very interesting because it feels like you're not just taking spells. You're taking like a power, and that power has like lots of little sub-powers which you can spend points on. You can spend a certain number of points per turn. It feels like its own unique system, definitely, just by looking over it. And I like that they're doing that for one thing. And I find it a very interesting system. I'm a very numbers-based guy, so I don't mind keeping track of things like side points and stuff like that. So I think that also is a reason why I kind of am like, ooh, interesting.
The math major being a number points guy?
I don't... Yeah, I know. No, number skill. Mm-hmm. It's what I'm good at.
Unless it's very late at night.
Well, then it just becomes simple arithmetic errors, which happens anyway.
Yes.
I mean, that can just happen.
12 plus 16 is 30.
I argued that for like 5 minutes. I don't know why. It was like 4 in the morning. Which can,
yes,
can
it,
you help?
It was extremely late. I will admit that. But it was just funny hearing the math major being so resolute about it. That's the answer.
I
know this.
I know this. This is truly what it is.
What base system are you using, sir?
Base 8. No, that wouldn't be a base 8, but that's besides the point.
Yeah, right. I think it's pretty cool. I think there's a lot of different ways you could play it as well, so I like that. I have to say, being, you know, someone who's played, like, I played a paladin, a warlock, several other classes, I'm a little jealous that there's so many orders right off the bat. Like,
yeah.
Because everything else has, like, oh, you get, like, 2 or 3 options. I think there's one maybe that has 4. And it's, like, this one's, like, got, like, 7 orders. I'm just like, wait a second. Why do they get 7 orders? Why do they get such a big choice?
The only thing I can think of with that is because psionics was already kind of defined previously, they took a lot from what they had already defined. They're like, oh, we can just do all of it at once.
Yeah.
And maybe because they've done arcanas for other classes anyway, that give extra options possibly to use. Maybe that's why.
This is the first delve into psionics, so they want to give you a good choice, since the other ones are like expanding on other classes that already exist.
Yeah, it's like its own chapter that can be added to your core book now. So,
yeah, really.
Because it has everything.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I feel like I feel another reason they did it, too, is because, like we were saying, like Soul Knife, Wu Gen, Nomad. I remember these being, like, versions of classes and stuff you could take from Psionics in, like, 3rd edition and stuff.
Yeah, in the Psionics Handbook, these were all classes under Psionics.
Yeah, so it's like, now they're just orders in there. Well, I think the Nomad was an expanded one from, like, one of the expanded things, still.
Expanded Psionics, maybe, yeah. But I knew, like, Wu Gen and
Wu Gen
Soul
was,
Knife were both, you know, from the original.
Well, Wu Gen was also different, too, but it was its own class. Yeah, I don't
right,
think it was
that's
originally...
What I mean.
Yeah, it wasn't, like, Psionic. It was some kind of weird... I think they had it Divine because it was in Oriental Adventures in 3rd edition.
Okay.
It was like some kind of weird divine arcane something or other. It might have been a mixture of the two, which is why it was really strange. And then they're like, it's just psionics now. we're just making it like a mind power because it's less confusing. And
right.
I feel like maybe immortals are like the psionic warriors a little bit. I guess the awakened, maybe those are just the normal scions, I guess. And I'm not sure about the, like, maybe the Avatar and the Immortal and the Awakened are, like, splits of that. I don't know. That's kind of interesting. But I do feel like Immortal, yeah, is definitely more like, you know, Psychic Warrior. We have our Soul Knife. We have a couple other things in there. Like the bunch of basic classes they had before. They're now,
right.
Like, here's this. Here's what we got. They're now, like, variations on it. And the fact is you get different disciplines from different groups of disciplines. So that makes a difference. Mm-hmm. And also, like, you get vastly different abilities. Because you really do. Like, a soul knife, you're getting, like, a soul knife. Which no one else has. And you're already, like, changing it vastly. You know? And you're like, well, you know, you have some... They don't talk about the disciplines you get.
Well, you get a bonus discipline. they have in there, which is at first level, like for Soul Knight, at first level, you learn two additional psionic disciplines of your choice. They must be chosen. Oh, that's Wujin. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Because I get them too, but I'm guessing maybe it's not like the other ones. It talks about bonuses. Maybe you just don't get a bonus one. And that's one of those things.
Yeah, maybe certain ones you do. Oh, yeah. No, they do have one for Order of the Nomad.
Yeah, all the rest of them, I think, have a bonus. Well, I think they're switching their bonus one, which would be specifically from their grouping of disciplines, with I have a soul knife. I stab you with it.
Yeah, the soul knife's awesome.
Yeah.
I mean, you have consumptive knife at sixth level. You may slay an enemy creature with a soul knife attack. You immediately regain two side points.
Yep, and you could spend them to do extra damage and attack for 10 minutes. That's pretty good.
Well, in Phantom Knife, you can phase through most defenses as an action. You can make one attack with your soul knife and treat the target's AC as 10 for this attack.
That's kind
of their actual AC.
That's actually kind of really ridiculous, because I guess it's just like you're just like, yeah. Because you're just like,
here's your heart.
My knife phases right through you.
I think that's pretty awesome.
Yeah.
God.
Soul
knife mixed with rogue.
Oh god. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Then you just dirty.
Because you're sneak attacking then too.
Sneak attack into your heart.
Oh.
Yeah.
And I'm sure
take like two in rogue and then the rest in soul knife.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I haven't taken a real good look at all the disciplines, but I'm sure there's gotta be like a couple disciplines in there that like will affect your attacks or something. And I'm sure those are the ones that be like, well, you know, stuff. Like, oh, here's one. The Immortal Discipline of Psionic Weapon. Like, you're like, okay, you know, I guess you'd technically be holding your soul knife. Because then you can make it do an extra D10 of, from 1 to 7 psi points as a bonus action, and each one would deal an extra D10 psychic damage.
Oh!
You're like, yeah! Oh my god.
This is murder all around.
Oh my god.
Even better, just a whole party of rogue soul knife. Just that's all you need. You don't even need healers or anything anymore. Just them. They just do enough damage to not even worry about tanking or DPS or anything.
Okay, so the soul knives you are made of energy, and they project from both your fists. You can't hold anything in your hands while manifesting these blades, and you can dismiss them as a bonus action. They normally deal a D8 point of psychic damage on a hit.
For you, a soul knife is a martial melee weapon with light and finesse properties. There you go. It counts as a weapon in your hand. Murder, murder, murder. Oh. Let's use that. Oh my.
It's Assassin's Creed with soul knives, though. You're just like, shink, 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 shink. I think it'd be a lot of fun, personally.
I will agree with one of the persons in chat who says, I don't want to see the players having any of this, seeing any of this stuff. Oh my god. Yep. Oh, wow. No, I find it's I like it a lot, but again, yes, that's like, it's a little ridiculous, so. And again, I do have to say.
Millions of DMs cried out in pain.
Yep.
Well, again, we do have to watch out. The big thing I know that we've been warned about, all these new classes, well, pretty much these two new classes, not tuned for multiplayer, so when we're experimenting with multiplayer, we'll have to see how they work. We're very experimenting at that point in time.
Oh, God.
So, yes, fun with Soul Knife. Why don't we move on, because we can, like, gush at the interest and grossness of this at the same time a lot.
What grossness? I don't know. I don't see what you're saying.
Yeah.
7d10 to the heart.
Just to the heart, though.
Just to the heart. Granted, you're using a huge... They're using... Well, I mean, you know, at 20th level, that'd be only a tenth of your psi points. And if you kill them, you get two back. God.
Hey, Sean, I got something for you.
20th level, you'd be... You guys would take on Strahd pretty decently. I think he's only like CR 6, like challenge 16 or something like that. He's not 20.
Yes, but I'm just saying, I got something for you. Stab directly to your heart.
All right. So, Why don't we move on, though, to the next topic I wanted to talk about? Well, Pathfinder put out a small player's companion, which I believe those are their, like, little soft cover books. And they're put out Monster Hunter's Handbook. Now, this is an interesting one because it made me think, and which is where I want to talk the topic. First off, monster hunting campaigns. Do we actually hear about a lot of them anymore? I, for one, don't hear about a lot of them. Not that, like, you couldn't come up as a subplot maybe hunting a monster. I've heard of that. But specific campaign of, like, hey, there's a dragon in this area. Go take care of that or something like that. And you go on, like, ridiculous quests to take on the dragon. But... I don't know. And to answer those people in chat, it is a little bit like that. It's a soft cover book, so it's not nearly as big. It has some tools for neutralizing specific types of creatures. It got some archetypes, feats, items, spells that are specifically for killing monsters and, you know, grabbing stuff. It's just a little bit of extra information, so. Yeah, and Olorant has said that he had a quest in a game that was Witcher style, you know, hunting a thing, but that was still, it's not the main quest. A main quest is something traditional that I can remember back in, like, really old days actually doing some of this. I don't think I've actually physically run one myself. I can remember, you know, like, participating in a few and stuff like that, but now?
I don't think we've done one in quite a while, actually.
Yeah. I think, like, the last one we could actually say was a monster hunting one was when our friend, Chad, ran that dragon hunting game. And specifically, he said, this is a dragon hunting game. You're going to be hunting dragons. I mean, as soon as you say that, okay. But, like, after that, it's like, I don't know.
Yeah, I don't think I've ever run or been in just a straight, like, monster hunting type game. So I'm not even sure how that would work or... I've been told side quests, go kill this thing because it's harassing the, you know, the town, but that's kind of the extent.
Well, I mean, you could easily do one that, like, you have like an elder dragon that is the main goal.
And I would think, like...
Or the Tarrasque.
Oh, my God. Well, you see, but the thing is, that's, like, when we talk about it, I feel like a monster hunting game is less long-term campaign and maybe short adventure to medium campaign. At most.
Right.
Like, if it's a medium campaign, you could have it like something like the Tarrasque, where you have to find some way of killing it. Or mm-hmm. It could be like you have to find where its lair is. Maybe it's like it's emerging from this jungle, and there's like a whole bunch of places in that jungle that you have to check out. And maybe perhaps, you know, what the players don't know is the places that they know to check out. None of them are correct, but they can find hints at this like other area that they finally go there and find the monster, hunt and kill it, you know, something like that. And then you can have it that it goes, it's a short campaign. I could probably get like 5-10 sessions out of that kind of thing there. And that would be interesting. But we don't see that anymore, really, you know?
Yeah, I mean, what I could also envision is a long-term campaign. Maybe the DM creates a very unique monster that you need certain parts from certain other monsters to be able to actually defeat it.
Mm-hmm.
That'd be a way to, you know, make a whole campaign of it.
What Chad had suggested in the discussion was like a guild sort of situation, which is, I think, is an extension on this, but different. Like, a specific monster hunting campaign is there's one big bad, you have to get it. Guild hunting is like the next evolution of it, that it's like there's a bunch of monsters, you're getting missions to take them. And I feel that one, that suggestion, goes for more the long-term campaign type, you know?
Yeah.
Because that's when I can go out and have a lot of different ones. Again, you can, like, sort of build up your guild or something, or support it, or things like that. And that's also a very interesting style of gameplay, which, I mean, I don't think I've seen a lot of recently at least. But these, like, there are other classic adventure ideas that I know exist that we don't see as much of. And, like... We see dungeon crawling, but when was the last time, like, I see it still. This one's the one that hasn't gone away completely, because I do still see them. How often do you see just a pure dungeon crawling campaign? I think the last ones is Pathfinder put out a couple of them. They put out, like, a small adventure, which I'd found, but that was an older one. and I think the Emerald Spire book I saw was pure dungeon crawl.
Well, there was our one friend's kind of dungeon crawler, which was the weird bank heist campaign that went off the rails.
But that wasn't really dungeon crawl. That was something he made up on his own, that we did go through a dungeon. The object of a dungeon crawl is, here's a dungeon, explore it, you know?
Yeah.
And that's the adventure of it. And it's sort of like, these ancient ruins no one has explored, here, you can go check them out and find stuff for me. Or find this artifact, or defeat this evil, or... There's like a billion things you can do to get people to go there, you know, excuses. Yes. Depending on the storyline. But you don't... I feel like a straight published version of that is not as common anymore, too. Is it like we've moved away from these, got more complex storylines? Because I feel we do have more complex storylines. It's not always a terrible thing, but...
Yeah, I think the focus has more been on, you know, the a big bad person than necessarily a dungeon or monsters.
Yeah.
It's like you find these, you know, you have these things in there, still tied in, but they're not the main focus.
Yeah, like it's centered more on a person rather than a location.
Yeah.
So, yeah, because I haven't played much Pathfinder. Well, I haven't played any Pathfinder, let me be honest.
Yeah.
But I've played, you know, 5th edition, 3.5, 4th, all that. But it is, like, I've never done one where it's just, like, going out in the world and, like, seeing what's there. It's always like, hey, this person is doing this thing and you have to try to stop them. Or there's, like, an end goal in sight from the beginning, so to speak.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which, I mean, is not always a bad thing. And, like, as I said, you could very easily come up with a simple end goal for going into a dungeon. Like, hey, this artifact needs to be retrieved. It's in this dungeon. I can't do it on my own. You guys who I'm just hiring, do it for me. I mean, that's a very simple quest. And if, like, we see, like, the big books from Wizards and the adventure paths from Paizo are all, like, really epic storylines. I think the, what is it? The Tales from the Yawning Portal, is it?
Mm-hmm.
That might be a little better, that we might have a little bit more of this stuff in it, so I am anticipating it, because isn't that supposed to be a bunch of smaller campaign, like, adventures or something? I thought I read that, but then again, I might have.
Yeah, I think, from what little I've read about it, it's supposed to be almost like a lot of, like, story time, almost, of some of the old campaigns, almost like just as if you were sitting around the story, or around the campfire telling stories.
Yeah.
So it's like, the kind of the perception I got of how it's presented. I haven't actually read it or looked into it more seriously, but that's what my initial take on it was.
Oh, God. Oh, my God. I didn't even realize until I looked at here. They have the Tome of Horrors on there. Tomb of Horrors. And they have Against the Giants. They have, like, a whole bunch of updates of, like, older adventures, it looks like, pretty much.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's cool.
Well, I mean... Like, I... Oh, God. I believe Tome of Horror is one of the best adventures ever for certain reasons. I have never played it. I mean, this would be an interesting one to try out because it is very death trappy.
What days are we playing that on?
It's not out yet, so we have to wait till April. Thank you very much.
That's Pathfinder, though, right?
No, this is D&D. They've got
D&D. Now we have. Wasn't it D&D that we talked about last week with the traps?
Oh God, yeah, and they have the updated traps from Unearthed Arcana. Oh my God!
So you could really have some fun there.
Like, add something into the. It's like I need to make the Tales of the Tome of Horror worse. I'm gonna add something ahead. But getting back, though, you know, I think that I like to see, because those are classic adventures that have been revamped for modern age. So I would like to see how those play out, definitely. And that might be like some of my worries about, like, these adventures that don't exist anymore. Maybe that's going to bring them back a little bit. I still don't know if the monster hunting campaign. I mean, I think maybe sometime I'll run a, like, monster hunting one shot or something. That'd be kind of cool to do. You could probably do it like one adventure or something, or a couple, you know, mm-hmm. That'd be cool. So, yeah. So definitely, Monster Hunter Handbook and thinking about monster hunting campaigns is something that maybe, like, maybe just talking about it a little bit will get some people interested in redoing them again. I certainly would not be against supporting the return of a type of game. But let's move on to an interesting topic, which thankfully Joe did some research for. So really, my topic is, when is a TV show or movie not supposed to become an RPG? That's the really heart of my topic here. Because My Little Pony Friendship and Magic has a role-playing game now called Tales of Equestria, spelled the way you think it's going to be spelled. And my entire question is there like a too far with this? And what's the point of this a little bit too? Because I'm trying to play this neutral ground here on this one in part of this discussion. And
When you first mentioned it, I will say I was completely and utterly like, no, my brain hurts. Why? But after, you know, investigating it a bit, it is more built for the 6 to 11-year-old range.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very, very simple system. You have 3 stats. I think it's body, heart, and mind.
Okay.
So
tri-stat system, similar to what Bessem does a little bit.
Yeah, and there's no bonuses. There's very little math that you have to worry about. Most of it's just straight rolls. You can get certain talents and stuff that give you, you know, bonus dice to the roll. And there's basically 3 kinds of horses. There's a Pegasus, Unicorn, and Earth.
Okay. Horse.
Earth is the beefy kind of more body focused. And the Unicorn is the magic focused one. Yes, I know way too much about this.
No, this is perfectly fine. This is perfectly fine.
That's cool.
There's things called friendship tokens.
Ooh, friendship tokens.
You get a number. Oh, go ahead.
I was just going to say, does it use like only D6s? Is it like a pass-fail system?
No, it does use different dice. It uses, I think, everything up to a D20.
Okay.
Each ability has its own die kind of attributed to it.
Okay, so it feels more like a little bit like the step system. Is it like a step system more like something like Earthdawn has? Or is it just like, you know, that it will tell you a dice with it?
It'll tell you a die that you're going to roll.
Okay.
And DM comes up with a challenge, a die roll that you have to beat of from 2 to 20. Okay. A 1 is an auto fail.
Mm-hmm.
And the DM's encouraged to do something like silly to the character or something. Like,
so
kill them.
Yeah, it's
I tried to do, like, there was a dance challenge and you fall flat on your face.
Okay.
Yeah, it was something kind of embarrassing. Not technically, maybe, or you try to dodge a falling coconut and instead of dodging it, you trip and fall face first into the tree and take 3 points of damage.
Yeah.
There's no death in it. If you reach 0, you just collapse and either you like start crying or you pass out or something. Yeah.
Oh my god.
It's mainly focused for children
or
hardcore fans of the genre.
The brownies.
Definitely family friendly oriented is the main part of it.
It's the role player in me would be curious to try it once.
Mm-hmm.
And beyond that, I'm not sure.
Yeah, fights are called scuffles.
They
don't happen as often. Most of it is trying to work together as a team to do different challenges.
Okay.
And with that, you have, like I was saying earlier, the friendship tokens at the start of the game and every level you gain. You get a number of friendship tokens equal to the number of players plus the DM.
Okay.
And you can spend friendship tokens to either gain an extra bonus die, to automatically succeed at a challenge, or you can spend a bunch of them to actually, like, add something into the story that wasn't there.
Hmm.
Basically bribe the DM.
Okay. So this is Okay, keep going. You have some more sources of that system.
Well, there's one more thing with that, is being the main focus of working together. If multiple people put in friendship tokens, it can lower the cost of how many friendship tokens you need to use.
Huh.
I think it sounds kind of interesting. Maybe, like you said, just run it once just to see how it plays, how it feels. I game with children for an after school thing, so it might be great to run with them because, yeah. For example, when I said we're going to run Mouse Guard, you guys get to be mice with swords. Like, they're more excited about actually being a mouse than how it works and what they're doing. They're just like, I'm a mouse, you know, because they're 11 years old.
Yeah.
So this would probably be right up their alley. They would just, like, you know, be all excited, like, oh my gosh, I get to be a pony, like, you know.
Yeah.
They're kids.
Yeah, and that's the thing, is that's the focus of what it is to try to bring kids into being able to use their imagination more and into role-playing. So I can see that as a great starter thing for younger kids who, like, you want to get interested in that or have really what they want to play an imaginative game. It's great for that. For me, I would not be that interested in it.
I understand. And the fact is, like, it's for me too. It's like, I'm like, well, it's like that, the curiosity of trying it once. And then after that, I'm like, well, I mean, I don't know how interesting the system would be from what I've heard about it, from what you're saying, and what I can sort of briefly read about it, like, here online. It's sort of like, well, the novelty of trying it once, there's that. That's kind of what it is. Yeah.
It does come with a basic starter adventure that you're house sitting for the main six as they go on an adventure and watching their pets. And they do have something interesting that I actually do applaud them for. They are coming out with an actual adventure path soon for it. And that one is going to, they have a rule in the system that if a character does not make a session, they turn into a little standee of themselves that, like, the other characters can, like, just, like, put in their pocket or something, which is, like, that's kind of cute and a little, you know, third wall breaking. But there's the adventure actually is going to explain that there's a curse throughout the land that's doing this to the ponies.
Wow.
And why you're trying to find out why this is happening, that, you know, certain people are turning into these little figurines.
That's really interesting, actually.
That's what I'm saying. That I applaud them on. That's you know, kind of a little third wall or fourth wall breaking, which is great. And also, it can help promote their toy line because, oh, look, it's a little standy of me.
Yeah.
True. Very true. Very true. All right, but now that we've introduced to it, I did want to get into the actual sort of topic related to it a little bit then, which was, is there too far? That's what I wanted to ask about this, the entire thing. Now that we know about it, we can understand it a little bit better, which is helpful. Like, yeah, we can see there's a lot of different role-playing games for, like, okay, just coming up with your own world, that's fine. You know, we understand that, you know, fantasy, sci-fi, things like that. A lot of people come up with interesting worlds and then show them off to people, and then you learn about them. But when you're making something based on a existing property, that's I feel that's a little different, you know, because then you're trying to immerse yourself in a world that people have seen things for, either read books for, or watched movies, or watched a TV series, and you want to feel like you're part of that movie, book, or TV series. It's different than, like, I've got this sci-fi setting, you know, it's like, oh, cool, sci-fi setting, what can I make in there? Like if you're doing, I know there's a Star Trek one. If you're doing Star Trek, you want to be the crew of the Enterprise, you know, it's what you want to be. You kind of want to be like that and go on adventures like them. Granted, it's going to be a lot more diplomacy than blowing stuff up, but...
Well, that also depends on what timeline you're in. I mean, if you're in the Dominion Wars...
Yes, okay, fine. But...
Or if you're in the Romulan Wars or the Klingon Wars...
Yes, so there were wars you could have battle to. Okay. But I mean, like, what I'm talking about really is that... yes, thank you. But, like... when we're talking about
Middle Earth.
Yeah, like Middle Earth. You want to be like Legolas and Aragorn if you're in Middle Earth. Or I don't know how it works because I've never actually read it up. The Doctor Who ones. Is someone the Doctor and the rest of them companions? I don't know how that works. And who gets
to be the TARDIS?
I want to be the TARDIS, yes.
Because there's only one Time Lord left, so...
Yeah.
And there's other ones, too. There's, like, a whole slew of them.
Buffy the Vampire!
And granted, like, when we look at them, many of them, you can see them working. You know, figuring it out, working. They come up with ways of doing it, and it's like, okay, yeah, that's interesting. Like with Buffy, yeah, you could have someone be the Slayer, and maybe someone be a witch, or a werewolf, or, you know, something else there. Or the Watcher. You know, there's a lot of different roles for people to take that, you know, could work out. On the other hand, there's, like the Doctor Who one, where is there someone that's obviously going to be better than everyone else? I question that one a lot. And...
Right.
And so... Well, I mean, like, even, like, the Star Trek one. I guess someone gets to be the captain and stuff. But, I mean, even though everybody gets their cool things that they do, even if you're not the captain anyway. So, I mean, I can't bust that, you know? It's cool to be the captain, but sometimes you want to be, like, the security... You know, maybe you want to be Worf and be the security chief, you know, and do cool things, but, you know? Shoot people.
I think that, you know, you have to have... if you're doing it off a show, you have to have something that does have... Something that you can... attach some fighting and role playing and stuff to. Like, you couldn't do Seinfeld the RPG.
Okay. Okay, wait, no. As someone that goes through talking about weird games in Besom, because I have an entire line of those episodes on my channel, the surprising amount of things you can goddamn base a show off of is insane. I think I could do a Seinfeld one. Will it be exciting? No, it's going to be role-playing pure. It's just going to be, like, freaking, like, it's an episode of the week that something weird goes on and your characters have to resolve that, probably through lots and lots of talking.
But could you see something like that being successful?
Though? Oh, being sold? Heck no.
Like, I don't think something like that would work.
Oh, it'd be wonderful. Like, all these great ideas I have for, like, ridiculous Besom games, they'd be cool. But I'm using the same system. You know, that's what it is. And just coming up with systems on their own for something like that, nah, I don't see it being sold. It's like you were suggesting when we were talking a little bit about the My Little Pony the other day.
Care Bears.
Yeah, Care Bears. The thing is, like, who really thinks of Care Bears nowadays? My Little Pony is still pretty popular. I think they're still going on. They are because
they rebooted the series, and then, or if you really want to go back, Snorks with Snorks Adventure.
Oh my god,
I don't even know what that is.
They were the
ripoff of the Smurfs. It's an underwater ripoff of the Smurfs.
Yeah, they had a lot of ripoffs of the Smurfs
on their heads, and it's quite disturbing at times.
They had a lot of like ripoffs of Smurfs during those days. So I mean, you know, everybody was ripping off everything that seemed popular.
Of the 80s.
Oh god, 80s.
Yeah. And I think, like you guys are saying, I think that making a series into its own game with its own system is kind of ridiculous, whereas just adapting the setting to an existing system that fits it and that works. Like, maybe now that the My Little Pony one is created, you could use it to do Care Bears, because it's got kind of that, like, I don't want to say dumbed down, but like easier rule sets that kids are able to run, mm-hmm. and you could just kind of tweak things to fit for that setting.
And see, that comes down to, you know, which I'm perfectly fine if like the, like a person that has this that wants to run it with some children is like, you know what, Care Bears, let's do that with that instead. You know, that'd be really cool. And, you know, using the same system, I think that's what it is. It's like when you get like one or two of these systems that actually are very good and can easily adapt, maybe then you come up with it. Like, as I was saying with Besom, I talk about it with anime, but the sheer fact is I could totally use this system for a ton of games. It's not the simplest one, which is the only thing that's unfortunate. So I think like this one in this case, yes, I could do some old cartoons and stuff, but might not be as good for kids. Besom does have a little bit of complexity to it. But if, like, you had a bunch of fans of, like, I don't know, Thundercats, and you wanted to do it, I could totally come up with an idea for Thundercats and Besom. You know?
And I'll still trade my whip to speak English.
Because you did that in a Besom game. It's points. And he didn't have enough, and he needed to speak English because we were in a different area of the world, and he had a whip. And you decided to trade those points from whip to English.
Yes. That was silly. I don't remember my character sheet. I'm like, crap, I don't speak English. everything's point buy from, you know, stats to equipment. So it's like, I guess I'll not have a whip and I'll speak English instead.
Good time.
You could just become a mime. Just been a mime for the rest
of the game. Well, he spoke like Gaelic and Japanese.
Problem is, my backstory, I woke up in America under a Chuck E. Cheese parking lot. I was a vampire.
And he ended up in, like, some kind of school for unusual creatures and people from other dimensions in Japan or, like, off of Japan. So they all spoke Japanese there. So I'm like, I'll give you free Japanese.
So I had free Japanese, but with my backstory, it's like, I really should have learned English at some point, since I did kind of, like, bum around America for a while, and no one would understand me if I was just speaking Gaelic.
That's awesome. Ridiculous, but awesome.
The thing is, the setting was cool to play in, and the characters were always, all of them were a little ridiculous, which is the point of it. You're in your Bessem game, you're a little silly. There's a little level of it there. But I think, like, the way he did his backstory was one of my favorites out of all of them. It really was. The Chuck E. Cheese part was wonderful. You know, it's like, he had gone to America in the old days, it got, like, you know, bulldozed, and, like, they put a parking lot over top of him, and he's gotta escape.
Yeah, I had to break through a parking lot to get out of my coffin. And I'm like, what is this Chuck E. Cheese?
But anyway, but getting back away from a little bit off topic as usual, because, well, it's technically side topic, because it was Bessem. But yeah, it's interesting to see that there are so many of these systems on their own. Like, some of them, yeah, definitely I can understand. Like, Star Trek, there's Star Wars ones. There have been ones for things like Buffy, Doctor Who. I think there was a Babylon 5 one that existed, which
I'm pretty sure there was.
I like that one. I like that series a lot. It's just really old now, you know. It was a cool sci-fi series. But, Battlestar Galactica for one last decade that probably has a one for it that's probably would be relatively popular. You know, it's they come out with these for sci-fi and fantasy things. I think there's got to be a Lord of the Rings one.
Yes, there is.
Yeah. I haven't seen material on it.
At least one or two.
Yeah. But the fact is, since it exists, I mean, it means you can play it. And it's like fantasy sci-fi. They're easy to make role-playing systems out of. Other things...
Like a sitcom.
Well, even like...
Friends, the role-playing game.
I was just thinking that. I want to be Joey!
Oh, God.
Did your brain just short?
My brain just shorted for a moment there. It really just did. What was I saying? Yeah. There are other ones even that I think would have a little bit more trouble, like crime dramas or, like, you know, not that they can't be done.
CSI, you know, the game.
Yep.
You could probably do that, and that's not something that...
Well, I don't think... That wouldn't be as hard to do as a sitcom.
No,
because that, at least, there's, like, oh, okay, there is a, you know, it's an investigation game, which we've seen that done in D&D, in Pathfinder, that, you know, there can be investigation games.
Yeah. And as there was a suggestion, there's also a bunch of video game ones, too, with things like Dragon Age. That has their own one. There's other ones that I'm, like, surprised never got anything. But again, like when you say something like maybe, like, Final Fantasy, they wouldn't get it because all the Final Fantasies are their own worlds. So that's kind of, like, hard to do, while Dragon Age is all set in the same universe. I mean, that's a little easier.
Well, haven't they kind of stuck to the same universe, though, in the last, like, handful of
Final Fantasies? Not at all. They have, like, they've had sequels to it, like... You know, Final Fantasy X had X2, right. And Final Fantasy, I think it was 13, had like two sequels to it. But other than that, no, they're all different worlds.
Okay.
Ooh, and I've got a suggestion for the Zelda one using D&D rules. That'd be kind of cool, because you could just use those.
You could.
And the fact is, like, you know, using a video game world would be pretty cool for some of them. I think others, again, harder to do. Definitely.
Mario, the role-playing game. It's a me.
Yeah.
Lassie. I think you should do Lassie, the role-playing game.
Oh my god, Lassie, the role-playing game. Is Timmy down a well again?
roll your communication check to see if you can understand Lassie.
What is it, Lassie? Is Timmy down a well? No, not down the well. Where is he? In the thresher. I'll go check it. He's not in the thresher. He was in the well.
Yeah.
Fox and the Hound?
Oh, God. Let's not go the Disney route, because I'm sure someone somewhere had come up with rules for some kind of Disney something. Rather.
Probably.
Oh, I'm sure. Five Hole Goes West.
Oh, my God. The Five Hole series. Thank you for that one.
Or Fern Gully.
If Fern Gully would be interesting. Well, there's a lot of them that, like, we can pick out that, like, would be interesting to play in. But interesting to play in is different than, like, coming up with its own rules and publishing, rather than you cobbling together something on your own using an existing system. And I think that's a big difference, you know? Is just, like, what deserves its own system or not. Probably something that's popular. Probably something that's got a great idea.
One last one.
Excuse me.
Video games.
Sure.
Paperboy.
Oh, gosh. I want to be the rock in the road.
I'll be an angry customer because you broke my window.
Yes.
Oh, cool. So someone used, like, the common system, like Fate, and converted a Marvel Superheroes game into a G.I. Joe game that worked out really well. That would be awesome. Cool. I would have loved it. Like, the thing is, like, just like a G.I. Joe one would have been wonderful, too. Definitely. Anyway, why don't we move on, because we had a great discussion on this. I think that was very interesting. We did learn a little bit about that system, and the fact is, you know, it's fun to adapt a system, definitely to an RPG system, and we'll just have to see, you know, if they get to a point where they keep deciding to publish things if we feel like they've gone crazy. Now...
Tetris.
Tetris, yes. Not
I do
so
want
much.
To point out one thing, though, with the My Little Pony game that's very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Is the creator actually worked on games previously, like Warhammer. He's mainly worked on, like, ultra-violent RPGs. And then he had a daughter.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's why he designed the game.
Yep. Cool.
Yeah, that's quite the flip there.
Mm-hmm. All right, why don't we move on to the last topic for today before we get on too late. This is one we were probably going to talk on a little less. We're going to talk about free versions of games, basically. Now, granted, like, when you're doing a Kickstarter, sometimes they give you, like, free PDF versions along with your physical versions. Sometimes you can still get them. But, like, for something like Secret Hitler, which is an interesting, like, you know... it's not werewolf style game, it's what's that other one, I'm not thinking, resistance style game, where, like, there's, like, a couple of enemies in amongst a group. You can still get a free PDF copy. I got the free PDF copy because the fact is there isn't a whole lot to print out anyway, but then it gets into, like, Vairs, which is apparently, like, it's a game I didn't know a lot about. It's a freestyle rap card game, kind of a weird kind of concept, but I'm like, you know what, there's a lot of weird board games out there that are very interesting. So, you can get a free copy of it now. It's a PDF. You print it out on your own. Get your own cards. There you go. Got the game. Will they do this with more board card games? Is this just because maybe they want to... They don't have... You know, they're not ready to sell it anymore. What's going on that... Like, there must be a story behind it. And, like, I guess it's maybe they want certain people to buy it, certain people won't buy it. Maybe getting, like, free copies, people will be able to try it more, and then we'll get them to buy it. It's interesting that I feel like there could be a good reason behind it being free.
I think a kind of a good one might be you know, the resurgence of the vampire trading card game.
Yeah, I mean,
I don't know if there would be a resurgence if they didn't do those free printable cards.
That's true, because you can't. They don't. There's not money in printing them. You know, there really isn't.
Right, and that's what I'm saying is, you know, I think you know from what we've seen, it might actually make a comeback and might you know start getting sold again at some point. And I think the reason for that is that you know they started doing the free cards to try to get people back into it.
And the thing is, this was a Kickstarter at one point in time, too. Or is it a Kickstarter now? A Kickstarter... Oh! interesting here. Interesting learning a little bit more about it. It is indeed going to be a Kickstarter for a physical copy. They're releasing a print version of it, like a PDF version of it now that you can get. But they will have a Kickstarter for more physical stuff. So I think that's this is a take I didn't even think about until I was looking at this now. They're using it to gain support.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's sort of like we think about, you know, spreading word of it afterwards, or maybe they released it as part of it and they're keeping it along there with it, you know, something like that. That's fine. But to drum up support, it's an interesting way of
putting it. It's a good promotional tool of something. You know, if you're trying to create a trend, you know, giving the freebies out isn't a bad idea. And then once, you know, and you see it, okay, we don't have to put a lot of money into, you know, creating the cards then and everything. Let's see if this takes off. And if it does, then to, you know, switch gears and go, okay, now we're going to actually sell this and make this a real thing.
And the thing is, it's a freebie that they can do very easily because it's just make a PDF, provide it online. Everybody else prints it out on their own.
Right, yep. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, yeah.
It makes sense as a promotional tool. It would even be a good idea for someone trying to create, you know, a new kind of game, and they want to test the waters with it, and instead of going and spending all this money on, you know, printing product and everything else, see if there's an interest for it first.
Yep.
Now, granted, I know this won't work with every board game or card game, because some of them are much more complex, and you probably couldn't really print them out. But, like, for something like this, which is like a deck that you draw cards from and use it, it works fine, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, and I know I've backed a lot of stuff on Kickstarter, and a lot of them offer different tiers, and you can get, like, the basic tier, you know, maybe $5, you get a printable, like, your own printable version that you could just use, you know, to test it out and stuff. Some of them, even if you back, you know, for $1, you know, just throwing in $1 towards their way, they'll send you like the pre-release versions of the PDFs that you can print out and play on your own. So you're not really getting the full game maybe, but you're getting like enough of the game that you'd be like, okay, I played it. I know I liked it. I read the rules. It's really well done. Maybe I'll buy it when it, you know, hits my local game store to actually show the support. Or you paid $1 and now it's like, it wasn't a game for me.
And also, you know, you're getting other people to look at it too, who didn't even, you know, you paid $1, but then you're showing it maybe to 10 other friends.
Yep.
And they get interested in it, and, you know, rally support. And then once it comes out, it's like, oh, there's 10 customers right there that you didn't have before.
Or for like here with the Kickstarter, it's like, which is coming out soon, it's like, oh, well then, I feel like I want to support this, you know? This is really cool. No, this is actually a really interesting idea on it. And I think, like, we've seen, as I said, free copies of stuff sort of floating around. But I think this is probably one of the better uses for it. And I feel like sometimes the excuses behind it are not as good as this one. But this is a really good one. You're like, I don't know why, but I liked the fact that I could get that free printed out copy of Secret Hitler, but, you know, I've never been able to play it. It would be fun to do just because it's a terrible game, but also a way wonderful game. Resistance style games, they're wonderful, you know?
Yeah.
It's like when someone's basically a terrible person in amongst your group and basically trying to get rid of everyone else.
Yeah.
Exactly. it's a lot of fun. I played it at a birthday party and stuff because, you know, we're better to play it than at somebody's birthday party. we're
congratulations.
Adults, man.
Congratulations. I'm Hitler at your birthday party.
God, yeah, really.
Pretty much.
That's what I got.
Yeah. So it's a fun game, and it's like if you can get a free copy of something just to test it out at least to know if you're going to like it, then you might go, okay, it's definitely worth the $35 or $40 if it's one of those games that's running for the higher prices, because there are games out there that are super expensive.
Oh, yeah, that's true. That's one thing I loved when I went to Florida years back was there was this one really great game store, and they had so many copies of games that the store had as demo copies.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a lot of the more expensive games. So you could demo it at the store, go, okay, yeah, I do like this, instead of spending, you know, $80 and finding out, okay, this isn't my bag, I just wasted $80.
Yeah. I've We've got a few games like that where it's like we bought them on sale because it's like, okay, it sounds really interesting. Played it once. We're like, good thing it was on sale because...
Yeah.
Yeah.
I have a few of those. One was a random... What was it? Random Encounters, something or other here that I found completely horrible. Yeah, Plains of the Troll Killing. Random Encounters, Plains of Troll Killing. I'm like, oh, this looks like an interesting 8-bit graphic type card game. This might be fun. And I think it was like $20, and I think it, at most it should be worth like $5. Yeah, yep. I was really disappointed in it. I'm like, you know, and you don't, that's why with these, you know, free trials and stuff, you know, these free printable versions, that makes sense. You can see where your customer basis is and be able to focus, and, you know, you're getting people, you're getting word of mouth out about it.
Yeah.
And also you can have it like, you know, you wouldn't be disappointed if you're like, oh, like, and you've tried it out, you know what's in it, then you could go to like, how much is it going to be? Is that worth it for me? Because it is different for each individual too. And, and board games can get so, yeah, they can get so expensive, as we're saying, you know, and card games, you know, they can get up there. There's like $80, $100 games. Granted, a lot of those have like huge amounts of miniatures and stuff like that and like complex stuff that it, you know, it's like they're molding huge amounts of plastic. So it's like, yeah, okay, yeah, $100, I can see it, you know, but still, that's expensive.
Yeah. Right.
It's like, before I spend that, I'd rather be able to, you know, demo it and make sure it's something I want than spend $100 and be like, wow, and maybe leave a bad taste for that company in your mouth.
Yeah.
I think even, okay, so even if you didn't provide, let's say the cards, like if it's a card game, you don't provide the print and play version of the cards. I think a good policy would at least be to provide the rule sets.
Yes,
like even if it was just like a bullet point of like, this is the basic makeup of how the game plays, because I've bought games where we opened it up and we were expecting maybe, you know, a 8 to 10 page rule book and it's a manual. Like, it's a textbook. And I'm like, this is supposed to be a 30-minute game, and it's going to take me 45 minutes just to read the rules.
Yeah.
Why? Like, where is all the complexity coming from, you know?
Right, so, if it's played that fast, where's the complexity?
Exactly. Yeah.
Now, and the thing is, I know for, like, our group, most of the time, if I'm there, they're like, here you go, read these rules.
You're the designated rule reader.
Yeah, I'm a designated rule reader. It's because, like, that's what they really rely on me for, because it's,
you're
like...
You're good at skimming through them.
I'm good at understanding things, so you have a question you could ask me.
Got it.
But, yeah, I mean, you it's good to go know what you're getting into a little bit more, either free copies or at least something free provided. And granted, you know, final product might be a little different, but, hey, it gets you an idea about it, and it drums up support. And I think that's a good way of doing it. And the thing is, it does technically work beyond, like, a Kickstarter. I could see, you know, like when they're being sold. and then you're just like, here you go. You know, this is what the you know, if you're interested in the game, you can check it out here. Know if you like it. And, you know, purchase it.
Yeah.
Itch.
Yeah.
All right, well, why don't we finish up for today with, of course, stories from the table. So, Rachael, I have an idea of a stories for the table for me to Joe to tell, but we're going to leave you open to whatever you wanted to tell from some kind of story from the table. We're going to go a little bit of, I don't think we talked about really Bessem in depth for us, did we, Joe?
No, we haven't.
So I was going to talk about at least one of our Bessem games today. Maybe that one we were talking about with your vampire. That might be a fun one to talk about. And so if you want to talk about, like, a game you ran or a game that you were a player in that you had some kind of cool character, go ahead. Share a story.
All right. So I'll just actually go with the most recent, and that's I mentioned that I run games for kids. It's a volunteer thing I do on the side. And most of the kids are between 10 and 17. Well, the ages range from 10 to 17. Majority are actually between 11 and 13. So they're, you know, they're the younger kids, they have the shorter attention span, but I've been playing Mouse Guard with them, and I did tone down the rules quite a bit because, again, short attention spans. I wasn't 100% comfortable and familiar with the rules when we started, so I kind of modified it as we went, like, all right, we're just gonna not deal with that because adding this in is going to confuse them. But they just loved it. I mean, the one girl, I would ask her, you know, okay, so you guys, I gave them a really simple task. They had to shovel snow off of one of the paths between two of the towns. And they just were all over it. They were like, all right, let's do this. I'm a big strong mouse, so I have a big shovel. And the other ones, you know, well, I'm a small mouse, so I'm the leader. And I'll tell her what to do and keep a scout out. And they just, they were so up, like, excited just to, you know, shovel snow. But after they returned, you know, they got back to town, they were able to avoid a riot because they'd been told that the shipment that had arrived in town was 2 crates short. So their town was short on food for the winter, and they did some good, basically diplomacy checks to avoid them all getting crazy. So it was fun, but it's, I do really like watching kids get excited about, you know, games, even if I'm just kind of like, okay, I'm not really into this system, but I thought I'd try it. They seem into it. It's really, really fun. I recommend playing for kids too. They have no inhibitions, and you can be as ridiculous as you want, and they're just like I was saying, they're hula dancing in the library for them because they told me to hula dance. So
no, it's, you can have fun, and I think that's one of those things is you want some of that, like, fun there, you know. You don't want to be too serious, but too silly either, is what my kind of thing is, you know. It's always find that great balance that, you know, I feel like, you know, maybe not too young, but like that, like, you know, like, you know, closer to like 10 or so, like very early years. I feel like, you know, from, you know, back in my old days of trying to play AD&D with a bunch of those back when I was really young, you know, back when I was close to their age, when I'm a 12-year-old trying to lead a bunch of 10-year-olds in AD&D, that was good memories. Crazy stuff, but fun. I remember that. But then again, I was a terrible DM then because, you know, I'm 12.
Yeah. Well, it's a trade-off.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. As long as you had fun and didn't kill each other.
Yes, and didn't kill each other, at least for that long. But now I did want to share, of course, the story of the Besom game that Joe brought up because, you know, talking about open-ended RPGs and stuff like that got me thinking about that one, and I don't think we've talked about it. I've done a few Besom games, but this is the one that I do remember the most because I tried running it twice. So I set up that they were in, like, an Earth world where basically portals to various weird other dimensions and, like, fantasy places all opened up and dumped a whole bunch of people, and then they closed up. And, of course, there was also, like, ancient mystical things that awoken, like, i.e. Joe's vampire, you know?
Yeah.
So
nothing better than digging out of a Chuck E. Cheese parking lot.
Nope. So we had, like, a lot of weird characters. What was it? The reincarnated angel pop singer was one of them.
Mm-hmm. And did the angel not know they were an angel?
Sort of. He was absent-minded. Then there was, like, the quintessential cat girl. There was cat girl ninja, because cat girls. Because always cat girls. There was the guy who wanted to be Mega Man X and made a terrible character. There was super martial artist to the max.
That was Cindy, wasn't it?
It was Cindy.
Yes.
Which I warned her not to be experts on everything she could possibly do, and she was an expert at most of the things she could do. She was
an expert on everything. It's like, why are you at this school then?
So basically it's like, well, there's a lot of people with superpowers now. We're setting up a series of schools. And there was one that, like, was recruiting people to be basically good guys. One that was recruiting people to
basically be villains.
Yes, but they didn't want them. They wanted to be villains that could get along with society, basically. It's like, teach you to channel your villainous ways in good ways. And then there was a place for everyone else that really didn't have either of those tendencies where I had everybody ending up in.
The neutral school.
But, so the only thing I have to say about this system was building up the NPCs for the class was stupid, and I should have only built them when I needed them for adventures. Because otherwise, it was kind of annoying to try to build all of them. Because building a PC in Besom is not always the easiest thing, especially when you have a pretty decent amount of points. Which everybody has a pretty decent amount of points. So, And the adventures were kind of cute and fun. And you guys were trying to, like, do schoolwork. And you were getting some kind... I had some other kind of mission on the outside of the universe. There was, like a forest on the island that was, like had, like, mystical energies in it that, like, you were going to explore because it had been, like, partially merged with dimensions or something ridiculous like that. But, you know, it was interesting. And they went on adventures. And they were meeting really interesting characters who... Every one of the... NPCs in the classroom was based on something else that I'd come up with. So I had characters from everywhere that I could think of, like a whole bunch of different weird characters. Oh, I forgot, one of the PCs was Sherlock Holmes, what shoots people.
Oh yes, Sherlock Holmes, what shoots people.
Because he told us, and his Watson was a giant mecha.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Seems legit.
And and his arch nemesis was Robot Moriarty.
God.
And the pop singer got a proposition from the gym teacher.
Yes.
Named Platinum Claw, and I was like, Platinum Crawl have crawls in contract.
Oh.
It was the worst line. No, the thing is, it was a terrible line, it was a terrible concept, and just the look on his face was the best part about it.
I also remember you did a good job of reining me in,
uh-huh,
and not allowing me to do certain things like having vampire teeth with home-seeking capabilities.
Yeah, that would have been ridiculous. I also remember that your love interest was also your arch nemesis, because you kind of had like the vampire hunter chick who wanted to kill you, but she was inept at it, but also kind of liked you or something too, so it was kind of weird.
Yeah, it was kind of like a Buffy and Spike kind of scenario there, yep, going on.
Yep, except rather you weren't trying to kill people and she was inept.
Yes. So I don't do that anymore. I've gotten better.
I mean, there was such great things there that it was so fun, and like the Besom system, and because I like opened it up to everything, it was a wonderful game. It's just a shame that we didn't continue it, and then when we returned, not everybody remembered like the way they were acting with their characters, so like things changed and fell apart. I would love to redo that system again, or maybe even do that game again someday, but probably not overwork myself when I do it that time.
Yes,
because smart.
It's experience. You learned.
Yes, I loved the Besom system, but I learned very easily. You know, I went too far on it for a one game master to spend enough time to do. Yep. It was controlled absurd, I call it. That's what it was. Controlled absurd. Because as silly as everything was, it all worked. And you guys could be relatively serious in-game, which was the interesting thing about it, you know?
It was almost like a somewhat serious, silly game.
Yeah.
Organized
like,
chaos.
Organized chaos. And it worked. I think Besom does very well in organizing chaos, you know? Because it's an anime or manga-based game system. It's got a little chaos anyway.
Right.
But why don't we move on to gaming sage advice? And I do have a question I do want to ask, but because I've been trying to do this theme, and I do have one that I came up with today, different than one I sort of come up with a few questions, but just in case, like, Rachael, if you have something that you think would be a cool question to discuss that we could talk about that would help people out, you know, something related to gaming, any kind of gaming, go ahead, you can give it. If you don't really have one, that's fine. I have one that would actually pertain very well to you and pertain a little bit to what you talked about, which I came up with, that I think would be interesting to discuss a little bit more.
I actually don't have anything off the top of my head, so I'll let you
That's
go
fine.
Ahead and get
okay.
started.
So rather than the one I was thinking of, because you brought up children, what would be... what's a great way of bringing younger audiences? And I'm not just talking about children. I'm just talking about younger audience, maybe even some like early teens, you know, stuff like that. Great ways of bringing in younger people that work really kind of without dumbing things down too much. That's what I'm going to say. What do you think would be the best way of doing that? You know, you talked about, you know, for yours, changing the rules around a little bit. I'm interested to say, like, what would be if you were going to bring these younger audiences, maybe like even like 10-year-olds, because by then, you know, they got a little bit more attention, and bringing them into, you know, 10 or above into a role-playing game, like even something like Dungeons & Dragons, what do you guys think would be a great way of doing it?
Oof.
Yeah.
So I would start probably with getting them invested in the world, I think. Because even more than getting invested in their character, which will naturally, I think, happen once you start playing, I think you want to get them invested in the world and the setting. So if you're, you know, if you know you have a 10-year-old who's really, really into, you know, like a military setting, maybe setting the stage for that to kind of play off his interest first, his or her, I just went with his. But, you know, maybe start there. So, like, okay, you're dropping them into, if it's D&D, a world that's, like, engulfed in this massive, like, civil war going on, and you want to start with that to get them kind of interested in the world first, because once they build their character, every character I've ever played, it seems a natural progression that I become invested in my character as I play them.
Yeah.
So I think that's a good start. At least that's where I would try to start. That's kind of how I pitched it when I did the Mouse Guard, is I said, you know, hey guys, you're going to be mice. Like, this is where you live. You're going to get to fight weasels and this, that, and the other. And they were all gung-ho. So maybe just showing them, you know, the world first, and then doing the characters, kind of working backwards, big to small.
What do you think, Joe?
I definitely agree with you. You have to get them vested in the main world/story that you're trying to do. I agree that, you know, character, you're going to become invested in your character most likely. Unless you end up doing something that you thought was going to be cool and you just end up hating it. I've had a few characters like that, you know, I'm just like, I don't quite mesh with this, with the original thought. But no, I think you do have to start with creating an interesting world that's going to get their attentions. Maybe even find out, you know, if they have some common interests and stuff that you can kind of build into that world that is already going to bring that excitement in.
Mm-hmm. I think I would add to it, too. You want to build investment with characters, too. I think that's going to be important, too. So you're investing the world, and you're maybe rather than, because at this age, they might not be great at, like, making a character or something. Maybe you want to ask them a few questions, see what kind of character, build something for them based on what they want. And then, you know, like, even, like, as you're introducing the world to them, introduce each of their own characters. Give a little bit of information about what they said, and then let them fill in the blanks. Sort of like we know now, you know, building a story for our characters that we have. But you want to foster that, you know, what would my character do? What am I acting like this character? You know, things like that. That might also be a good part of it to help include them in, kind of like make them feel like, oh, I'm being this person, you know, in this world a little bit more.
Yeah, I think one of the things that when I played the game with, six of us, I think, that one of the things he did in the first like handful of sessions, just to kind of get us prompted, is he would do an icebreaker. So he would ask us stuff, but from our character's point of view. So he would say, you know, last session you met this person and your character didn't really seem to get along with them. Why not? You know, and so then we would have to kind of first remember what had happened in the previous session and then kind of put ourselves back in our character's shoes and then step forward again going, okay, I didn't like them because, like, they're hardcore followers of Tyr, and I don't believe in that god, or, you know, whatever it was. So, I don't know. Yeah. I think icebreakers are good, too, to help, at least from session to session.
Yeah, I can definitely see that. I mean, that, you know, that way you also are getting invested in each other, then, and understanding where each other's coming from helps create a lot more bonds between the characters.
Yeah, and I think that's a good thing, too, is to get them to sort of interact with each other very well. So it's like there's a lot of steps. It feels like it's a rewarding thing because definitely you're teaching someone, but you're also, you know, it takes a little bit more almost to get them invested in it, which, you know, if you're trying to do it, it's what you want to do. It's, you want that investment. So very cool. All right. Anyway, so why don't we call it for today? This has been a great one. I think chat's been a little crazy, but that's okay. I've supported this.
We finally got an active chat. That's great.
Oh God, you know, the amount of active chat we get is mixed bag, and I've been happy about it. And you know, but anyway, so I think that'll be it for all the topics for this week. We will, of course, back next week, same time, 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. We'll see what kind of guests we can get. I think we're gonna have at least one person that's magic guest. He's either gonna be this week, that next week, or the week after that, depending on what kind of magic topics come out in the week. Of course, if you want to see kind of get an idea of what we're going to be talking about, I do have Gathering the Role. I put out like Tuesdays, Wednesdays, depending on when I can get out. That's going to be all the news stories and tabletop. We draw the topics from there. If you have any topics to suggest, you're always welcome to leave a comment on that video. Leave a comment when I put up the VOD of Discussing Tabletop on my YouTube channel. Or you can email me at discussingtabletop@yahoo.com. We definitely will take any kind of suggestions for topics that you think would be interesting for us to talk about what's going on in the tabletop world. Or if you have any questions for gaming sage advice, we'll also take you for that there. As I said, VOD should be up again also right around that time period, Tuesday, Wednesday. I want to thank, of course, my Rachael for being the guest this week. Rachael, do you have anything to promote?
I'm just going to give a little shout out to my podcast that I do. It's called Rules as Written. We're currently in a little bit of a transition period, switching from discussing D&D rules and how to break them, essentially, or how to keep your players from breaking them, and actually going to be transitioning into a little bit of live play. We're in the process of recording those actually today and this past week, so those will be coming out shortly. You can follow us on Twitter @RulesAsWritten, and that's kind of the only thing I'm working on besides this. Thing tomorrow.
Yep, which I'll be to promote in a second. Yep. And then, of course, we have Joe, who I don't think you have anything extra special to promote, my partner in crime.
Your game tomorrow.
Yes. As for upcoming things, yes, tomorrow in the evening of like 5 or 6, we're going to have the first main session with all four players, including these two folks here, for Treasure of the Lost Legion, the 5th edition Dungeons & Dragons Spelljammer game. So I'm Adapted Spelljammer. They're going to be on a ship. The Valkyrs win. They've taken flight. We're going to find out what's going on now. Also, I will probably still have my Sunday night stream of video games at 11 p.m. I've been doing a lot of Stardew Valley. I might get back to some Civilization. I know the friend of mine who I do multiplayer might be free on Monday to do with him, so I might do some multiplayer late at night then. Other than that, normal schedule for streams, which is up on the main page here under my information. The Treasure of the Lost Legion might be changed to later. I do want to talk about that with everybody when we have them together, just because one of the people might need to start a little later in the afternoons. If we have to change it, we'll just find out if people need to or not, what people can do. You know, we'll adapt. Mm-hmm. Anyway, if there's an update on that, I will probably also put that out on Twitter. So you can definitely follow me on Twitter. I have links to both my channel, and I think my Twitter is down in the information and everything like that. So if you guys need anything else, definitely. Thank you for everything. I don't think I have a Twitter, actually. Oh, no, I do have my Twitter down there. Great. I remember I put that in there. So thank you, everybody, for watching. I do look forward to seeing you next week or for the next shows if you join us. So bye, everybody.
Have a good week.
And until the next time, bid you farewell.